Queen of Hearts 2019. Anne, a successful lawyer, lives in a beautiful modernist home with her two daughters and physician husband Peter. Yet when Gustav, Peter's troubled teenage son from another relationship, comes to live with them, she forms an intimate bond with him that jeopardizes her perfect life. And what initially seems like a liberating move for her soon turns into a disturbing story of power, betrayal and responsibility with devastating consequences. A daring tale of a flawed human and the wreckage her action and consequential denial leaves behind. Most will condemn for being as disgraceful as her deviant actions are despicable. Her decisions are obviously uncalled for morally speaking. The hints of her own victim experience as a child in foster care leaves just about enough of an explanation to reason the action leading to unavoidable tragedy. Viaggio Celebrity presents top 15 movies like Queen of Hearts. Number 15. Sub Rosa 2014. Bullied by his father to grow up, a teen fight between the love of his stepmother over his father's life. Sub Rosa is the coming-of-age story of a male teenager who has grown up under the shadow of his authoritative father. Over the course of a single summer, events transpire which transform this boy into an adult who challenges his dad in very unorthodox way. Runtime of the movie is 22 minutes. Movie is directed by Christian Dellar. Star of the movie are Julie Kendall, Mario Nallini and Mario Temps. Movie is written by Brian Trotman and Ronaldo Vines. Number 14. A car accident resulted in the death of 16-year-old Nikki, the passenger in one of the cars involved. 2 years after the accident, three families are still profoundly feeling the effect of the devastating event. Nikki's mother Catherine can't get over the grief of losing her eldest son. She refuses to let anyone touch Nikki's things, which still lay as is in their home. Catherine's grief results in her neglecting her husband Dale and their younger son Brady, who lives in Nikki's shadow. College professor Walter, the drunk driver in the other car, was found not criminally negligent of the accident. He has self-doubt about his life, which manifests itself in his drinking. Since the accident, he has been having trouble relating to his wife Abby and looks for solace from Sherry Banks, one of his students. Also in the car that night was his autistic brother Dennis, who has not been able to leave his apartment since due to fear. And Nikki's friend Jordy was the driver of the stolen car in which the two were traveling. Jordy has just been released from the youth detention center where he's been housed since for the theft. He has become a sullen young man. His father, a psychotherapist named Carl, hasn't forgiven Jordy for that night, which in turn has affected Carl's relationship with his second wife, Jordy's stepmother Alice. Number 13. A Woman's Hell of a Thing 2001. Angus McFadden plays Houston, a Coloradan who owns and edits a Maxim-like men's magazine that focuses on beer, cigar and fart jokes. He's got women coming out of his ears, a hot blonde who is a model, a hot blonde with a son who sees him as a husband material. When Houston's mother, a woman he hasn't seen in several years and hasn't even talked to in 5, dies, Houston heads to the funeral. He meets up with Zen, his ex-girlfriend from 10 years ago. But soon Houston finds out that Zane has been named executor of his mother's estate. Worse, Zane has been his mother's secret lover for the last 3 years. The film follows Houston's emotional evolution as he comes to terms with his mother, his dead father, his family history and Zane. In some ways, however, the film cheats just a little too much. Houston is supposedly a ladies' man, an outright misogynist who thinks women should be barefoot and pregnant. Houston is set up almost as a caricature. He blames his mother for his parent divorce. He idealizes his father. He believed his father's tall tale about shooting a grizzly bear 6 times on the family ranch land. He's a homophobe. He holds his family's land in the salt of awe, only in the way that people who have never cared about land can do. Number 12. Are You Here? 2013. Ben Baker is a man child who lives on his friend's couch getting high. His friend Steve Dallas is a moderately successful weather reporter who is living a superficial life. When Ben receives word that his father has died, Steve drives him home and they reconnect with Ben's successful and driven sister Terry and hippie stepmother Angela, who is the same age as they are. The reading of the will drives Ben to come up with a new purpose in life, but those around him don't prove to be very supportive and then they all re-examine their own lives. Are You Here is a comedy drama about the coming of age Jack character. This movie is directed by Matthew Weiner, so it's not your everybody laugh out loud comedy. He does a wonderful job of showing the ever-changing maturity of Jack character. This is a movie centered around drama and family. Owen Wilson delivers a few laughs, but it's not the usual Owen Wilson humor. This movie is rich and fun if you are going in expecting less comedy and more drama. Number 11. Electra, 1996. The discovery of a miraculous serum capable of giving youth health and superhuman power arouses the interest of Marcus, a megalomaniac billionaire bound to a wheelchair. He sent his assassins to seize it, but the discovery is no longer in the laboratories. While the younger man tries to escape with his girlfriend, the beautiful and mysterious Electra comes forward, determined in her turn to get the serum. And the fact that the beneficial effects are now transmissible only through love does not worry her. The expression train wreck, where you can't pull your eyes away from something so terrible because of a perverted sort of pleasure. It is a fairly interesting psychological exercise to watch this film and try to imagine the thought process behind the idea in the film. If psychology is not your cup of tea, an equally enjoyable time can likely be had from watching this movie after a few beers. Number 10. Shadow Boxer, 2005. Mikey and Rose are professional assassins. They are also lovers, and once upon a time, Rose and Mikey's father were lovers. During an elaborate hit job for a malicious gangster, Rose failed to kill the main target, the gangster's pregnant girlfriend. Number 9. Hellam Poe, 2007. The 17-year-old Hellam Poe is a weird teenager that misses his mother, who committed suicide by drowning in a lake near their house in Edinburgh after an overdose of sleeping pills. Hellam spent his spare time peeping at the local and blamed his stepmother Verity for accusing her of killing his mother. After a discussion with his father Julius Poe, Hellam sneaks out from his house and travels to Edinburgh, where he sees Kate Brack and becomes obsessed with her because of her resemblance to his mother. Kate hires Hellam to work in the kitchen of the hotel where she works, and they have a strange romance. While Hellam reaches his maturity in the hardest way, Mr. Poe is another indie coming-of-age dramedy with a hip indie soundtrack about a charismatic teen with psychological problems. Hellam is a film about a boy who misses his dead mother and ends up striking up a relationship with a woman who looks like her. Normally, film handles the Oedipus complex a little tactfully, but Mr. Poe goes right for it and pulls no punches. Even after they set it up, they go to the well once too often. Number 8. Little Boy Blue, 1997. Living in the rural Texas, Panhandle is a dysfunctional family. Ray, an abusive dad, a Vietnam vet with a war wound that left him impotent. Kat, a compliant wife, and Jimmy, a 19-year-old son, who have an incestuous relationship at the insistence of the dad, and two small sons who look a lot like their brother. Ray harbors a secret and he goes to murderous land to keep it hidden. Jimmy slip out in the shed has suspicions. but little come out until Doris, a Yankee woman of middle age, comes to town looking for a dead private eye. And why does Dad keep calling Jimmy Little Boy Blue? This is one of those southern gothic flicks involving family secret in a small town with characters and events that make your skin crawl, yet you just can't stop watching. About halfway through, you will think you have got it all figured out, but one or two of the revelations towards the end will probably take you by surprise. Ryan Phillippe does an outstanding job, showing that even early in his career he was more than a pretty face, as does Natasha Kinski, who guess also saw she was more than a pretty face. One quirky aspect of the script is that various characters will be just about to learn something important when the scene will cut away, leaving you, the viewer, in the dark. It comes dangerously close to being an annoyance, but the upside is that this allows the final act to spring its surprises all the more effectively. Number 7. 40 Shades of Blue, 2005. Wealthy music producer Alan James lives with his beautiful Russian girlfriend Laura, 30 years younger than him, whom he met while he was in Russia on business. They have a 3-year-old son. Alan is a music legend, having produced music during the 60s and 70s, the golden era of Memphis soul. They live affluent life in a sprawling mansion on the bank of the Mississippi in Memphis, Tennessee. But although she is comfortable, Laura feels lonely and isolated. Alan has an estranged adult son from a previous marriage, Michael, a literature professor who is married and lives with his wife in Los Angeles. Michael and his father have a complicated relationship that is marred by disappointment, hampered by jealousy, and fueled by anger. When Michael returned home to Memphis for the first time in many years, although he had at first disapproved of his father's young girlfriend, a painful and dangerous love affair developed between him and Laura, his contemporary. As this forbidden passion deepens in the bedroom and bars of modern Memphis, Laura comes to an illuminating self-confrontation that will change her soul and her life forever. Number 6. Mujeres in Files, 2004. The film shows three women in relationship and their different story of infidelity. When Cecilia, the star presenter of the television newscast with the highest rating in Chile, is about to give a story in which she revealed the result of a survey that states that 62% of Chilean women are or have been infidels ever. Ironically, she belonged to this 62% since she maintains an extramarital relationship with the owner of the channel in which she works. With Malays, a rival colleague exposed this relationship during the live broadcast of a fire in a motel. The revelation triggered others, and the subject is ramified, including other topics such as love satisfaction, loneliness, or abandonment, becoming a subject of national interest. Yet another good movie to come out of Chile, which continued to be one of the least appalled of the Latin American countries where filmmaking is concerned. The story revolved around the women in three different relationships: the married television newscaster having an affair with her boss, the secretary at the television studio having an affair with her husband's son, and a third wife whose husband uses her simply for his own gratification. The story began with a gas explosion at a motel where the newscaster's boss is killed, and the injured newscaster herself is revealed as his lover in a live broadcast that her husband and the boss wife both see. The three individual stories are further complicated by a fourth wife unable to get satisfaction from her unresponsive husband. Number 5. Stepmom, 2016. Junha had the best night of his life with an older woman he met while drinking. He starts looking for her as he can't forget the feeling, and finally they meet. However, she is going to become his new stepmom. She is his father's girlfriend. When the three start living together, things turn edgy and then dangerous. When his father leaves the house one day, the original title of the stepmom is Sa Uma. This movie is directed by Kim Moo Won. Lead star of the movie are Jo Yi Ban, An Jung Woo, Lee Soo Min, and Kwak Ji Un. Runtime of the movie is 99 minutes. Number 4. Ambivalence 2018. Stace and Peter, two young psychiatry students and friends, perceive life differently. Stace desires to act by the rules. Peter prefers experimenting. Stace is a hard worker while Peter likes to break the silence. Stace loves with hate. Peter hates with love. Stace is a diligent student. Peter is a troublemaker. It's a pity they both have one patient, Katrina. Stace's loving stepmother, father's wife, a tourist guide for Peter, a lover. Will their friendship stand the test of patience for the woman? This is an intriguing story about an unusual love triangle, and that madness is closer than it seems. The mysterious word in the title of the film means duality. First, Stace will nobly enlighten the viewer with the courtyard meaning, and then the professor will, at the most opportune moment, tell the young resident his scientific definition, history and classification. How important this painstaking chewing and speaking out loud is for the film is. Of course, rhetorical question but necessary. After it, for example, it become clear that ambivalence is not life on the screen but a dramatic work built according to ossified pattern. Create thanks to carefully written archetypes, carefully selected scientific concepts and cultural references. Heroes talk about ambivalence, Mans and Dreamers by Bernardo Bertolucci, are discussing the image of Saint Sebastian and shooting from a bow. Number 3. Stepmother's Purpose 2020. One man divorces his wife and falls in love with a woman who frequents the bar alone. Even if they are both aware that the man has a son and the woman in the bar has a daughter, they decide to live together. One day, as she left alone, the mother cleaned the house and accidentally sees the paperwork and find out that the house and all the properties are inherited by her son. With her eyes on the property, the following day she tried to seduce her son by exposing her body. The movie is directed by Lee Ru-woon. Actors of the movie are Yoo Jung, Sung Yeon, Lee Sul and Jung In. Runtime of the movie is 73 minutes. The original title of the movie is Se Umma Ui Mok Jek. Number 2. A Fish Swimming Upside Down 2020. A love triangle on the border of conventional moral concept. Andrea, in her early 40s, is a woman without a past, playful, direct, light, energetic, honest, unpredictable. She and 50-year-old Philip have been together for some time and decide to move in together. Andrea's presence should fill the gap for the deceased Hannah, wife and mother of the house. 19-year-old Martin is Philip's son and loves and desires Andrea too, and his life is limited to his own four walls, jogging in the wood and meadows, and the pool in the front garden. He gives both of them the cold shoulder at first, but she brings a new lightness into the large empty family house, and when she also turns to Martin, she becomes a projection surface for both men. For one summer, their longings seem to be fulfilled in a love triangle in which it is unspoken who knows what from whom. But expectations grow, and while Philip withdraws into passivity, Martin develops ownership claim. The three of them become more and more destructive of each other, and ultimately become bearers of a common guilt. A reduced, well-composed arrangement of imperfect, dead, deeply human figure fighting against inner emptiness. Number 1. You Carry Me 2015. Three daughters battle for acceptance, redemption and new opportunities. Dora is a neglected girl who dreams about becoming a football manager. Suddenly, her outlaw father enters her life and they build a close relationship. Eve, a director, nurses her father who suffers from Alzheimer's. As she loses him, she gradually loses the ground beneath her feet. Natasha, successful producer, is pregnant. When things go awry for her, she decides to confront her estranged father. All three carry their fathers, yet they need them to confront themselves. You Carry Me is actually a really untypical movie for a country like Croatia, still burdened by the war which happened over 20 years ago and today burdened by hard economic status. which is not getting any better. Croats and Croatian cinematography unfortunately center their themes around these widely known situations. And what is yet to be discovered is why Croatian cinematographer hesitated to explore less familiar grounds. Ivona Čuka is obviously not that kind of a filmmaker, although she has admitted the story has some biographical elements. Čuka's You Carry Me is nothing like the movie to which Croatian audience is used to. Powerful female character dominate this three-way divided story presented in a non-traditional roles, which is rarely seen in such conservative society. Well written and smartly directed, You Carry Me will carry you to the new era of Croatian filmmaking. Made in co-production with Slovenia, Serbia and Montenegro, it was expected Čuka would search for actor outside the domestic borders. Fortunately, Vojislav Brazovic was selected for the role, a Serbian actor who has probably won all the prizes they were to win in former Yugoslavia. Hence, favorite story of all three is the first one, about demented father whose daughter Eve is trying to cope with his illness.